أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على نبينا سيدنا أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As you are observing, we have some honored guests among us. The representative of Ayatullah al-Azma, Sayyid Ali al-Husseini al-Sistani, Hafizahullah, in the person of Hujjatul Islam al-Muslimin, Sayyid Murtaza Kashmiri, Damavillo, is here with us tonight with his special guest who has arrived from Egypt. And then we have ulama here also sitting next to us. To all of them and the guests who arrived, and to you all, we give a hearty welcome to this program, which coincides with the 40th of Marhum Munsir, son of Haji Anwar Bhai Danji. May Allah bless his soul with maghfirah. Before I proceed with that limited time that I have at my disposal, I think it is necessary to know that the guest we have among us tonight is not an ordinary person. He has been speaking to the public at various centers for the last 1 week, and he has just arrived from Manchester, and I can understand how tired he should be with the delays that occur when you travel by air. It is said that when you have time to spare, travel by air. And he has come here to fulfill the promise, and he has been given a subject to speak on in Arabic. Of course, it will be translated into English. But he is a thinker, and he is a convert to our faith from as back as 1975. And in so doing, I am told by Aghaya Kashmiri Hafizahullah that the man has suffered a lot. His wife left him, he married again, and most of his friends, most of his people of the clan have also abandoned him alone. But the man is persistently struggling to see that the school of Ahlul Bayt is introduced among the people he lives. And he has got ambitions for which we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah may fulfill his ambitions. Having said that, we will hear him more and understand him better when he speaks to us. And I request you all that tonight we may sacrifice some more few moments to listen to him attentively. I'm speaking tonight on this particular aspect of life and death, which is peculiar to the teaching of Islam. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam said, that death is a continuity of life. Death cannot be construed as destruction of life. It's a very important point where a person who believes that once he dies, he is destroyed, is different from a person who believes that there is a continuity after he has gone from this earth. There is a contact between the spirit soul and the body. One is material, another is spiritual. There is a life which is much more enjoyable, grand, and splendid than the life that we have on earth. There is a continuity. This particular belief has got a very deep significance in human life. In English literature, we sometimes come across what is called Pascal's bet. Actually, that Pascal's bet has been taken from Islam, because those who have not studied Islamic literature will find that this is something new in English literature, that Mr. Pascal was one of the clergymen, Christian clergy, and in his debate with those who did not believe in Allah and in the Day of Judgment, he forwarded this argument. It is called Pascal's bet. But actually, this is a bet by Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. And we are not surprised that they are taken as English bet, because so much of Arabic literature was gradually translated into Latin and English languages. When someone came to our first Imam and he started arguing, and when Imam alayhi salam answered his arguments, finally, when the man refused to be convinced, Imam alayhi salam said, then now we come to one conclusion. That either you are right, that after death there isn't anything. It is a leveler, dust to dust. And there is no resurrection, no accounting for the deeds. You are right. Or I am right, that there is going to be one day when we will rise to account for our deeds. Now, let us say that you are right, then we are both have scored equally. At the most, I have taken pain to pray and fast and go to Hajj and all that. You have done nothing. But at the end, we are equal. But suppose I am right, what will happen to you? This is called a bet. The man could not answer. This has been taken into English literature as a Pascal's bet, where in the church he said, suppose we are right, what will you do? The question is that when a person in life believes that there is a continuity, and after having gone from here, there is a life which I will live, which will be happier than the life I am leading here on earth, every action that one takes becomes meaningful and also purposeful. For when you work for your own self or your family or the community or even humanity at large, when you serve in your any capacity, knowing that there is a day on which I will be rising to be rewarded for what I do, and that this work that I'm doing and the effort I'm putting has got some meaning behind it, some purpose behind it, then a man works with a purpose. If he does not have any such hope that there will be one day to rise and give accounts, then gradually, another thinking creeps into him, telling him that this life is useless. Why I am putting on all the efforts? For nothing. For there are a multitude of people who do nothing while I am alone struggling. But a man who is struggling alone knows that he has got his Allah to account for, gives a purpose to the life. That is one thing. And it is very important. It is for this reason that you will seldom find one who has understood his life ever committing suicide, because he knows that the life given to him has a purpose which he has got to fulfill. Our thinking is so superficial sometimes, and it has to be, because we cannot think very deep unless we are qualified to think deeply. Most of us even don't think. Most of us think that they are thinking while they are not thinking. Most of the time is just spent. We are not thinking. We have got desultory way of dealing with the subject. Just now as I am talking to you, if I start talking about the rose, at the next moment somebody will think of jalebi. You see? And this happens also in namaz, when I say, inshallah, I will pray and remember none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahu Akbar, and I see that bulb. And I say, I don't know who has made that sort of bulb. And how many color does this change prismatically? And by the time I finish my namaz, I'm still looking at the prism here. And then I say, oh, I forgot. This is how human mind works. It is a desultory way of dealing with things. But when one starts thinking deeply, then he pauses for a while and says, where am I going to? At that time, if there is a purpose in life and a continuity, and one has got assurance that even after having gone away from here, there is somewhere where the deeds have been recorded. Ghalib used to say, pakde jate hain farishton ke likhe par nahak. We will be, on the day of judgment, we'll be asked questions based on the writings of the angels. Pakde jate hain farishton ke likhe par nahak. Aadmi koi hamara dame tahreer bhi tha. I mean, when the farishton started writing, did anybody from our side stand there to see what he's writing? This is the argument, that there was no one from our side. He wrote whatever he wrote. Well, this is not the idea. The idea is that the action of human beings, according to Islamic philosophy, is entailed by the effect immediately. We do good and the effect is immediate, contingent upon the work that we do. Not that there is someone else writing it. This has been explained only to us to be able to comprehend. Otherwise, every action immediately follows with the effect of it. Good with good, evil with evil. And that is the reason why the second thing that this belief in continuity of life gives us is that we become responsible people, responsible for the act we do. In this world, so many criminals and culprits have gone unpunished. Some of them have gone back as saints. Well, they were not even saints, they were criminals. Because there was no such measure by which they could be caught. Some of them went scot-free, innocent, proved by the court, while they were not innocent. So then there has got to be a place where human person has got all the satisfaction that for whatever good is done, there will be good reward. And for the bad, there will be judgment and there will be a punishment for those who have wronged the people. So that gives us also a sort of a satisfaction and a sense of responsibility that nothing escapes. I may do good, and when Allah tells me do good and do not advertise, leave it for me to advertise, have that sort of confidence that He will advertise one day. The third thing is this, that since no one knows his death, no one knows. No one knows when it will come. No one has any inkling of when he will die. Everyone believes he'll come here forever. And if some young man dies somewhere, the other fellow thinks that it is not for him, it was for that man who died. This sort of self-complacence sometimes is very deceitful. Therefore, since no one knows when he's going to die, therefore this philosophy of giving us some thinking about continuity of life teaches us how not to become thieves of time. Do whatever you want to do now, for tomorrow is not in your hand. And pray for success to Allah, but don't ask Him to do it for you. You pray for success from Him, but don't ask Him to do for you. Do it yourselves. And do it as soon as possible, because you might not have another time. If you are spared and you get time, very good. Otherwise, there is no assurance that what good you want to do today, you keep it on tomorrow, and tomorrow might not come for you. So, you'll find that so many things have come in this particular belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that there is a continuity. When Alexander the Great died, they say that he died, he asked his people to keep his two arms outside the bayah, his janazah, so that people may see that he has conquered so much of the world, but is going back empty-handed. Came here empty-handed, is going back empty-handed. But one of the gurus of India has said very well, he said he came empty-handed, but he will go without the hand. There's no question of empty-handedness. He will go without the hand. If he is in the grave, one day the hand will come out. And if he is cremated, the hand will burn. So there is a time when you go back without even the hand belonging to you. You see? So, there is one particular line that has been drawn. Otherwise you would have been hopeless people on earth. And that is our relationship with those who have departed. If a young man departs, who has hardly reached the prime of life, who has a young wife and small children at home, and suddenly we find that he has died, there is required of us, it is required of us, that we should draw a lesson from that. If I have crossed that age limit, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bonus he has given. And if I have not crossed that, then it can occur to anyone. So while death provides a lesson for us, at the same time, there is one thin line. When we are told on every Thursday, if possible, and Friday, if possible, and if not any day you like, go and visit the grave. Are we only visiting the stones and the dust there? Is it only a visit to the dust and a mound of gravel there? When you enter, you find there is a board kept and we say, Assalamu alaikum, Ya ahla la ilaha illallah. Greetings to you, O people who believed in oneness of God. To who are you saluting and greeting? To the mounds of earth there? To the broken and decayed bones? Have you ever thought of this? The very fact that you enter, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after bearing his first sahabi in Gharqad, Gharqad is what today is called Jannatul Baqir, stood there to talk to him and said, Salam be upon you. You have seen the promise given to Allah and we are yet to see. You have gone in advance and we will soon follow. Somebody said, Ya Rasulullah, does he listen? Does he hear to what you said? The Prophet said, he hears more than you do. And in one of those particular addresses, Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullah salam alayhi says, something which really disturbs us so much, but it's the fact. All people who have gone before us, we are soon going to join. Do you know what has happened after you have departed? Your wives have married another husband. And if you are a woman, your husband has taken another spouse. Your estate has already been distributed. It is in the hands of others. If they want to remember you, they might. If they don't want, they don't. And whatever good they do, they are partners in good with you. Your estate is gone. Your family members have now had وَاحُزْنَا إِذَنْ قَطَعَ ذِكْرُنَا عَنْ خَوَاطِرِ الْأَحِبَّاءِ وَالْأَقْرَبَاءِ. What shall happen on then when our nearest relatives and friends will not even remember us? Not even their small talks. Perhaps they might remember us once or twice in lifetime. My grandfather was such and my father was such, or my brother. At that time, this line of communication was kept by Islam, that they are dead, but they are dead as far as this physical existence is concerned. But they are alive. They are a new station of life. When you say greetings to them, they answer you. When you give them goodwill, they understand you. Well, if it had not been like that, there would have been no purpose of visiting the graves. And not only that, but even when you come here and say, Isma Ifam, to a person who is already going in the grave, and you say Isma, Isma means hear, but Ifam means understand and comprehend. Listen and understand. Talking to someone who, according to us, does not listen, does not hear. If it is useless, then it is a useless practice. It is not, for he hears and he listens to what you are telling. That has been the line of communication, and it is for this reason, my friends, that when today we are for Marhum Munshir, this is a majlis where Marsiya was read and Yasin was recited, and this brief lecture is being given to just remind us what this life is all about. Remember that this was a good connection that the Prophet kept, that on 40th of it, on 10th of it, on yearly basis, remember, for whatever good you do for him shall reach him. If it does not reach, it is useless. So is it not a bounty? Is it not Allah's blessing that even after my death, he keeps the door open for good deeds and sawab to reach me? Do you understand this? Inna nahnu nuhyi al-mawta wa naktubu ma qaddarna ma qaddamu wa atharahum wa kulla shay'in ahsaynahu fi imamin mubin. We in fact give life to the dead. We write whatever they send in advance and whatever they keep behind. What do you keep behind? Once I am dead, what do I keep behind? My family? That is not the matter for writing. Whatever good deed that I have done, which is sustained after my going, the Prophet said, an alim who has left even a page of knowledge, when he dies, don't call him dead. A rich man who has done something good for the sake of posterity to benefit from it, don't call him dead. A good father or mother who has left a son who remembers him in the days of Islam, in the ways of Islam, don't call him dead, for he is living. So this is how the connection has been kept, and this is how we remember our dead, and we pray for them, and we do Fatiha for them, and we recite Surah Yasin for them, we give sadaqah for them, we make charity in their names so that the connection is remaining. And may Allah then forgive, for when so many mu'mineen constantly pray for someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his ultimate mercy will forgive him. Well, these are the ways Islam has taught us. I sometimes wonder, when a boy is born or a girl is born, they come to my house and say, Mullah sahab, ahalo azan deva. Are Baba, it is for you to give adhan, not to me. It is your child. You give adhan in the right ear and give iqama in the... It's not for mullah to do it. Islam did not teach that. And no one can tell me that I don't know adhan, unless he has never been to a mosque or he has not heard any adhan. Every Muslim knows adhan. Well, now, what do you say? Adhan is here. And iqama is here, and you say, qad qamat is salah, qad qamat is salah. The salat and the namaz has been established, has been established. Where is that namaz which has been established? You have told him in his ears, qad qamat is salah, the poor innocent child, according to the latest psychological and biological and many other investigations, the print of the voice is always on the mind of the child. They have proved that even while the child is in the womb, if the mother has a habit of reading Quran, the voice of Quran has the impression upon the child. Right? I mean, if it is Quran. If it is television, then television. But there is an effect which cannot be denied. I have told the child, qad qamat is salah. Shaykh Nasiruddin Tusi writes on this beautifully, and he says that every iqama after qad qamat is salah has got one namaz immediately. Right? Qad qamat is salah, and then you say, wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatara as-samawati wal ard. Now I have totally directed my all attention towards he who created the heavens and the earth. If here qad qamat is salah is said, ulama tell us, leave and abandon all sunnah. Stand up, for it is qad qamat is salah. don't talk. If you are reading Quran, Quran you can keep aside. If you are in Sunnah prayers, break your Sunnah prayers to join the wajib, which is Qad Qamatis Salah, because it is a declaration that Namaz has been established. Correct? You can see in the books of fiqh. Now here the child has been told Qad Qamatis Salah. Where is the Salah? Shaykh writes that this Salah will be on that day when he'll be brought here with kafan, and Mukhisa will say As-Salah three times. There Namaz-e-Mayyit does not have Iqamah, does not have Adhan, because it has been said. It was said when he was born. Now this Salah does not have this. This is the Salah for which Iqamah was told. The meaning is that my lifespan from the day I was born till I arrived here in Janaza is equal to Iqamah and saying Takbiratul Ihram. Do you understand? For the life has got to be wajjahtu wajhiya lilladhi fatara as-samawati. The desire in this life will never end. The young man passed away, may Allah bless his soul with maghfirah and give patience and forbearance to his parents, his brothers and sisters, his immediate family, his wife and young children. We pray. Desires never, never, never fulfill. The only place where desires will be fulfilled is in the life here in فِيهَا مَا تَشْتَهِيهِ الْأَنْفُسِ وَتَلَذُّ الْأَعْيُنِ وَأَنْتُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ تِلْكَ الْجَنَّةُ أُورِثْتُمُوهَا بِمَا كُنْتُمْ تَعْمَلُونَ. That is Jannah which you have been caused to inherit as a result of your deeds, where everything that you desire shall be there. Only place. Not on this earth. Therefore, my friends, we have been given lease by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in that lease of life, let us start doing that which we do for His sake, for His pleasure, that in the life hereinafter, Allah may reward us, and in this life, those who leave behind us may remember us well. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.